Good morning, Westside. How's everyone doing this beautiful Sunday morning? Everyone doing well? If you would, let us please stand as we start our worship out this morning. It'll be 461. We'll sing that first verse of He Hideth My Soul. He hideth my soul on the left of the rock. Let's lift it up on that first verse.
Oh, wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. Oh, wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows of brighter sea there. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, that covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Good to be in the Lord's house today. We're so happy you're here. If you're a first-time guest here with us or watching online, we'd love to connect with you. If you'll just fill out this little tear-out section in your bulletin and drop that in the offering plate as it comes by, we'd love to connect with you and learn how we can be a blessing to you in your walk with the Lord. Or you can just text us, text the word welcome to us at 859-986-3444. Our scripture reading today starts in Psalm 122, verse 1, says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. And Isaiah 2:2-5, the mountain of the Lord. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be lifted up above the hills, and all the nations shall flow to it. And many people shall come and say, come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall decide disputes for many peoples. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk into the light of the Lord. We light this candle as a sign of our hope, our joyous hope that can be restored, our faith restored, our strength restored, our confidence restored, our joy restored, as we watch and wait with all God's people for the promise to be fulfilled. Let us pray. Lord, we love you and feel your presence today as we've heard your word and fellowshiped with the saints, and what beautiful truth you've given us in that scripture, Lord. Peace on earth. You brought us reconciliation, Lord, and through your Son. We're thankful for that, Lord. Give us the continuous heart of thanksgiving and praise. And as we worship you in song and hear the preaching of your word, Lord, we trust through your Holy Spirit you sanctify us daily. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. It is that time of year again, the Lottie Moon World Mission Christmas offering. Last year, our goal was $2,400, and we gave over $3,000 from you, the selfless and good givers at Westside Baptist. This year, though, our goal is $2,500, so we're bumping it up a little bit. This week begins the week of prayer for our over 5,000 missionaries around the globe. As you leave today, you'll be given the prayer guide at each door. There'll be one person out here, and two people up here. Our offering will go through the holiday season, so pray for our missionaries and pray about the amount that you give this year to the missionaries around the world serving the Lord. Remember, 100% of our offering goes directly to the missionaries on the field. May we hold the rope on our end to support them well, and as always, thanks for your giving, and may God richly bless you as you give. Thank you.
If you would, let's stand and continue in our worship this morning. If you're grabbing a hymnal, we'll be turning over to 446. Be singing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Let's lift it up on that verse.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Here, the earth to come.
seated. If the ushers would come forth at this time. As they're coming forth, again, we'll be giving offering through the plates today, but if you feel more comfortable, there are little white slips of paper in your all's pews, and you may turn it into the little white church on your way out today's service, and we'll count that towards your offering. As well, we have our church center app and our website, and if you'd like to deliver it by mail, we also have that up there for you. So let's go ahead and bow our heads and ask a blessing for this morning's offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day you've given us, Lord. Lord, may we always remember the hope that you bring and the hope in this season, Father. Lord, this week as I was listening to podcasts, I was reminded to always be rejoicing and having the joy of who you are and in your character and in every aspect of the Godhead, Father. Rejoicing in the character of our God the Father. Rejoicing in what the Son has done for us, Lord. And always rejoicing in what the Spirit moves and does through us now, Lord. Lord, may we always be this light and this warmth and joy and peace, and may we show it to the world this season and every day of our lives, Father, so that the world may look at us and see that we are different and ask for that joy and that peace and come to know your Son through that, Lord. I ask that you let this offering be the hands and feet of that ministry, Lord. May it be your hands and feet. I ask this all in your Son's righteous and holy name. Amen.
Well, this is a quiet little song that we hope you all enjoy. And if you don't, I'm sorry. I haven't done this song in probably over 20 years, so just bear with me, pray with me, and pray for me. All right, maestro. He has Jupiter for a pillow, an angel choir for a lullaby, clouds for a blanket, and the moon is his nightlight. But he don't ever sleep, 'cause he's busy watching over me. He rules the universe from his throne on high, but when I need attention, he is by my side. He's watching me. Yes, he's watching me. He's a busy God, but on his list of things to do, the number one priority is watching me and you. He's taking care of business, feeding birds and making rain. But he'll stop what he's doing when I clear his name. Cause he's watching, he's watching me. He may be busy watching rainbows or making demons flee, but he'll still find the time to make some time for you and me. He's watching, no, nothing he would rather do. He knows when I'm in trouble, he don't miss a beat. One eye's on the sparrow and the other one's on me. He's watching me, yes, he's watching me. He's a busy guy, but on his list of things to do, his number one priority is watching me and you. He's taking care of business, feeding birds and making rain. But he'll stop what he's doing when I speak his name. He's a busy guy, but on his list of things to do, his number one priority is watching me and you. He's taking care of business, feeding birds and making rain. He'll stop what he's doing when I speak his name. Cause he's watching me. Yes, he's watching me. Well, he's watching me. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother John. Amen. So good to see you all in the Lord's house this morning. We've already received such a blessing by being here. At the beginning of the service, we lit the candle of hope for the first week of Advent and celebrating this season. And today I'd like to carry on with that thought about the hope that Jesus gives, the hope that Jesus gives. In Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 12, the writer puts it this way: hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a desire fulfilled is a tree of life. Now we've got to be honest, when disappointment seems unrelenting and continual in our lives, it leaves us heart sick. But the second part of that verse, but a desire fulfilled is a tree of life. But when your desire is fulfilled, it can change a person's whole life. And just think, a good meal always tastes the best when you have hungered and longed for it for a while in your life. Sadly, we understand that in this world in which we live, there are too many people living with little to no hope. And maybe that even describes you this morning. And when people lose hope, they begin to die. Inside at first, yes, but nonetheless, when we are people without hope, we begin to die. Because mankind needs hope to be able to endure the pains and toils of this life. And we need hope to thrive in this life. And when hope is taken away, or we can't see it because it's masked by a lot of difficulties in front of our eyes, when hope is taken away, mankind becomes desperate, can become depressed and despondent, and again, eventually, even if it starts on the inside, a death occurs. And sometimes even strong-willed people, positive people, and yes, even we as Christians can become so overwhelmed at times with stress and grief that it dampens the joy that we are to experience through hope. I want you to know this morning that it is God's desire for you to live with hope. He doesn't want you living a life with no hope. And the other side of that that we've just spoke of is when mankind does have a strong hope, they can endure almost anything. We've heard such inspiring stories, even in the secular world, of how people made it through terrible, terrible times, seasons, and situations because they had hope. The thing about hope at Christmas time, you know, even among non-Christian people, even in the secular world, Christmas time is a season of love. It is a season of giving. It's a season of fellowship. But it's also a season of celebrating hope that we have. And also it's a season of renewing hopes that maybe have faded to some degree in our life. You will see and you will hear the word hope to some degree during the holidays. Again, even in the secular world. And to be honest with you, people use the word hope a great deal. I think so much that we don't even realize some of the times that we use it. But we need to understand when we hear the word hope, when we speak about hope, there are different brands of hope. Now, there's not as many as when you go into Starbucks and just want to order a regular cup of coffee. That's difficult to do. But there are different brands of hope. There's different types of hope. And I want to share a thought as we go through this on some of these different types of hope. There's four that we'll look at. The first being hopeful or wishful thinking. Hopeful or wishful thinking. And I tell you, this hope has a lot of superstitious vibes to it. Tori and I stopped at Speedway on the way to church this morning. And at the end, and what we got rang up to 666. Didn't bother me a bit. Didn't bother me a bit. I already know I belong to the Lord. And I'm not worried about how things ring up at Speedway. Amen? You shouldn't be either. But I have seen people get something else and add it so it wouldn't come up as 666. Hopeful or wishful thinking. This is an attempt to wish good things into existence. When we were young, it was as simple as wishing upon a star or making a wish as we blew out our birthday candles. This is hoping that the money will come through on time. Amen? Anybody been there? Or hoping that the bill will be delayed, Pat. I mean, we've been there too. Hopeful or wishful thinking. It's also assuming, again, I said it has a superstitious vibe to it at times. It's also assuming good things are coming when you see signs like the red bird at your window. It takes our desires and it tries to wish them into existence. I was laughing to myself this week thinking about this. This is what came to my mind is when we found out we were expecting our first child, Trey. And Paula was so adamant that it was a girl. Trey was supposed to be Emma Gale. And before we even got to the point where we could find out if it was a boy or a girl, and there were dresses bought, and there was talk of Emma Gale, and my mom even found a book about Emma Gale and bought it and gave it to Paula. And I remember so clearly the day being in that doctor's office when he said, "It's a boy." And Paula started bawling, and she said, "What's wrong?" And she said, "It's going to be just like him," and pointed at me. And so Emma Gale turned out to be Frederick Allen Livingood III, or Trey as we call him. Hopeful or wishful thinking. That's one type of hope. I would say probably the most common type of hope. Secondly, there is the hope of looking through a lens of optimism. Now first let me say that when we talk about being optimistic, I appreciate optimistic people. A negative person is draining. Draining. I mean, they will suck the life right out of a room or suck the life right out of a meeting, a negative person will. And so I do want to say I appreciate people who are optimistic, but blind optimism is not always reality, is it? And we know that. Nor is it necessarily faith. It can just mask the problems and not properly deal with them. It's being adamant, there is no problem. There's an old saying and an old song about looking at life through rose-colored glasses. Some of you remember that old country song. And that simply can mean that you're not looking at the reality of the situation, but that you're masking the issues and masking the color of life with blind optimism. You're looking at life through rose-colored glasses. Now, let me say this again. A Christian should be optimistic. But you can be an unbeliever and look at life with a blind lens of optimism. It's also assuming that we can speak good things into existence. In other words, if we say it enough, it's bound to happen. And so there is the hope of blind optimism. There's another hope that we see in life, and that's one of hopeful goals or dreams. Now, I want to say again, there's nothing wrong with having most goals that we come up with or dreams of something that you desire to accomplish in life. In fact, I'll say this, that a life with no goals can turn out to be a very nominal or mediocre life. However, we must understand that as Christians, goals for Christians should be sought out to be the will of God for our lives and accomplished with the Lord's blessings and strengths. But many times we find ourselves living in a daydream. I daydreamed a lot as a child. Daydreams of hopes and not in reality. We also think with hopes of reaching goals and dreams that if I do this and if I do it well, I will reach my dreams and then I'll be happy. This can be true at times, but we've got to be realistic. The truth is, that's not always reality. We could ask 1,000 young children, what's your goal in life? And many of them that play sports, Jason, what are they going to say? They want to play for the NFL and they want to play for the NBA or their favorite big-time college team. I know sometimes we need to be careful and not squash goals, but the reality is there are some kids who will spend many, many hours and weekends playing, but most of them don't reach that goal. Just a small, small percentage of the many thousands of kids, girls and boys that say they want to play for their college team or for the pro team, very, very small, minute percentage ever get to do that. We can sometimes do things right and still not reach the pinnacle of our hopeful dreams. Just to put it like this, there are some things that aren't just God's will for our lives. That's a tough lesson to learn, by the way. That's a tough lesson to learn. Some things are just not God's will for our lives. And as someone has once said, you shouldn't fear failure, but fear succeeding at something that does not matter in life. And there are many things that people have goals and hopes for their life that they don't matter in life, real life. So just to be clear, Jesus gives a real, living, and lasting hope. It's not just wishful thinking, it's not blind optimism, and it's not just lofty daydreams. But Jesus came so that we would have real, lasting, eternal hope. And that's the last type of hope that we look at this morning. It's a biblical, or I would say a genuine spiritual hope. We look at Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, and listen to the word of the Lord this morning. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through Him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, And we look at that. Rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. Now, what an odd thing. Why would you rejoice in sufferings? Here he goes on to explain. Knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. And what does character produce? Hope. And this is a godly, biblical hope anchored in Jesus Christ. And that godly, biblical hope does not put us to shame, the Scripture says. It does not put us to shame. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has given to us. Who has been given to us. And so the more that we live in the light of God's love for us, the more that we experience this type of living hope, a lasting hope, biblical hope, truly spiritual hope, anchored in the person of Jesus Christ. And the one who has placed their faith and hope in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior will not be disappointed with their decision of faith. And the Scriptures teach us that they will not be put to shame, and especially on the day when they stand before their Maker. They will not be put to shame. Through faith in Jesus Christ, as the Scripture says, we have peace with God now and we will forever. That's hope. That's hope. The Westminster Dictionary of Theological Terms defines Christian hope as this: the Christian anticipation of the future as the fulfillment of God's purposes based on God's covenant faithfulness and the resurrection of Jesus Christ as known by the work of the Holy Spirit in the church. And so biblical or Christian hope is anchored through faith in God and not in man. It is trusting Christ to be all that He said that He is and that He will do for us what He has promised to do. That's real biblical hope. It comes through the inner workings of the Holy Spirit in our souls. Biblical hope, listen, is not wishful thinking, although it will impact your thinking. Biblical hope is not blind optimism, although biblical hope should make you an optimist. Biblical hope is not simply lofty dreams, although it will cast a vision for your life now and for eternity. Biblical hope is not wishful thinking, blind optimism, or simply lofty dreams that carry us through this life and into paradise. It is a hope that God, in God, and that God is going to finish the good work of salvation that He has begun in history and in each Christian's life through Jesus Christ. This is biblical godly hope. And even when difficulties come our way, we can say, because of our hope in Jesus Christ, God will see me through. He will give me the strength to endure this. He's not wasting my suffering, and He will use this for my good in the end. That's a biblical hope. That's a hope that will last through the storms of life. You know, it's not that these other hope types of hope go too far in what they claim to give. They can't go far enough. That's the real issue. Wishful thinking can't take you as far as true biblical hope. Blind optimism doesn't restore you like true biblical spiritual hope. 1 Peter in chapter 1, I'll read two verses from this first chapter, the first being verse 3 and then verse 21. And the Apostle Peter wrote, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to His great mercy. He has caused us to be born again to what? A living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and through him are believers in God, verse 21, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory. Why did God raise Jesus from the dead? So that your faith and hope are in God, not in man, not in daydreams and goals, not just in wishful thinking, not just if I say it enough, it'll happen. But it's based in the person and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hope in God is a higher kind of hope than all other hopes. And this is the kind of hope that Jesus gives unto us because he is living. And he's coming again. And he gives unto us a living hope, a lasting hope, once we have been born again by grace and through faith. The hope that we find in Christ can endure even the most difficult attacks and tragedies in this life. And it can keep us going until that one day when we are called home to glory or Jesus' return, whichever happens first. Lee Strobel, a Christian author and journalist, defined Christian hope like this, and I really like this, and this is from his book, A Case for Hope, that hope is the inextinguishable flicker God ignites in our souls to keep us believing in the prevailing power of his light, even when we are surrounded by utter darkness. I don't know about you, but I know there's a miracle in every pew. And I also know there's heartache in every pew, and there's challenges in every pew, and there's rejoicing in every pew as we work our way through seasons of life. And we're all in different seasons of this life that we're living. But I know many of us have experienced dark, dark days. And those of you who knew the Lord and trusting in the Lord, even as dark as it seemed, even as your flesh was saying, we might not make it through this, there was that small flame of hope, that spark deep in your soul that kept you going, wasn't it? That's the hope that God gives. And so it's not so much, and listen to this, young people especially listen, it's not so much what we have our hope in, but it's who we have our hope in. And once we get that settled, then we can experience real, genuine hope, even in the midst of great heartache. Beloved, that's what it means to put our hope in Jesus Christ, to look to him as the Son of God, God in the flesh, who came to us, who lived a perfect life. He was born of a virgin. He lived without sin, though he was tempted as we are. He took our sins upon the cross of Calvary. He who knew no sin became sin for us. He bore our sin and shame at the cross. He was the sacrificial Lamb of God. He was killed on that cross. He died. He gave up the ghost, it says, when it was finished. They laid him in a borrowed tomb, and on the third day, by the power of God, he arose from the dead. He was seen by many for 40 days after the resurrection, and then he ascended into the heavens with the promise that he would return and totally fulfill all of redemption's promises and plans. And hoping in this Jesus Christ is to put your faith and your trust and your hope in him. And don't put your hope in heaven. Put your hope in Christ, and he'll lead you to heaven. And to give your life to him, to turn to him and to turn away from the world. This is what it means to put your hope in Jesus Christ. You know how most of the world treats salvation? And I mean even other religions, this is basically how they treat salvation, that the thought for many is this, that I hope I make it to heaven, or as I said, other religions, to a better eternal state. And most people believe this, well, if my good outweighs my bad, then I'll make it to heaven. But the question is this, how do you know how good is good enough? If you feel that way this morning, how do you know how much good is good enough to get you into heaven? You're trusting in yourself and not in Jesus Christ and what He did to purchase our freedom and salvation. You know, really, when you think about it, that's like taking a test at school, but you're not given the grading scale. And so here you sit down with this test, but nobody can tell you what an A is, or what a B is, or what a C is, or a D, or an F. I don't think they use F anymore. It's something else, isn't it, Christy? Do you use F? I had a few of those. That's like sitting down to take a test and you don't know the grading scale. That's how most people are living. And so their hope is not a biblical, genuine hope, but it's a wishful thinking hope. Well, I'll hope that my good outweighs my bad. And I just hope I can make it to heaven, or again, for other religions, to a better eternal state. That maybe I'll come back as a cat and not a flea. You know, if I believed in reincarnation, I'd like to come back as a cat the way our cats live. But they're fat, too. I feed them way too much. They're just hoping that their good outweighs their bad. This is a hope so, think so, maybe so salvation. It's not a real hope. It's not a biblical hope. It's not a genuine spiritual hope of the Holy Spirit. It's not a gospel hope. And it's not the hope that Jesus came to give unto us. We understand that. That is not the hope that Jesus came and dwelt among us to give. Jesus came and has given us a real, living, and lasting hope. And when we put our faith and hope in Jesus, we are made to be at peace with God, and we are not put to shame, as the Scripture says. As we think of the season that we're entering, Christmas time, you know, we should celebrate and remember the Lord Jesus' birth, because it was a time when God visited us. He gave us real hope from heaven, and He fulfilled more of His promise to hold fast to His family of faith until He comes again and completes His redemptive plan. That's hope. And so, yes, Christmas is a time to renew our hopes and to worship the God that came to us in the flesh. It is a time to renew our faith, our hope, and love for Emmanuel, God with us. It's a perfect time to give our lives to Him through faith, whether it be the very first time we've ever done it, or we continue to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice unto God. Because it's our reasonable worship. Let me just say this as we begin to come to a close today. Don't hope in Christmas. Don't hope in a season. Don't hope in a date that's been set aside for man, by man. Don't hope in Christmas. Hope in Christ. Hope in Jesus Christ. Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 28 says, "The hope of the righteous brings joy, but the expectation of the wicked will perish." The NLT puts it like this, "The hopes of the godly result in happiness, but the expectations of the wicked come to nothing." When our hope is in Christ, we can sincerely and rightly celebrate Christmas because He has come and He has made the way to God, and we can look to the future with hope when we go to Him or whether He comes to us. Now, beloved, we've looked at some different types of hope today. I want to ask you, in all seriousness, in all honesty, what kind of hope do you really have? What kind of hope are you holding to? What kind of hope are you exhibiting in your daily life? And I've prayed before I stepped up here today, as I have this week. I've prayed that your hope is anchored in Jesus Christ by grace and through personal faith in Him. May God bless you today with the hope you need to see you through. May God bless you today. And beloved, if your hope is in Jesus Christ, you will not be put to shame. Father, thank you, thank you, thank you. In a world where there's many different hopes to choose from, there is one true living hope. And we have that because of you. We thank you for the hope that you give through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for how your Holy Spirit stirs our hearts and ignites the flame in you to keep on hoping and to keep moving forward, no matter what may be surrounding us. We rejoice in that today. Our Lord, if there be one here today who is not exhibiting a biblical, genuine hope, but maybe because they really have never fully placed their life into your care, may your Holy Spirit, Lord, fall heavy upon them today, and that you will turn their eyes to you, and that they will see the one true living hope of mankind. Have your way in our life, not only at this moment, Lord, but also through this Christmas season. Help us to look to you, to worship you, to love you, Lord, to stir up that wonderful hope that you give, that will not be burdened down with the weights of this, of society and how they worship Christmas. And I ask these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, and all of his children said. We offer an invitation today. If there's a decision that you need to make, the altar is open. Maybe to receive Jesus Christ for the first time in your life, or maybe just to come to the altar and pray. Maybe there's another decision that the Holy Spirit has laid upon your heart, or you just need to come and to pray about things going on in your life. Whatever it might be obedient to the Holy Spirit and fix your eyes upon the one true hope of mankind, Jesus Christ. Let's stand together. Yeah. Lord bless you as you go. May you also be a blessing to others. Check on each other this week and through the holiday season, and share that hope that you have in Jesus Christ with others that you come into contact with.